بسم الله. We stopped yesterday with 207 and 207. He said, وَمَنْ فَرَّقَ وُضُوءَهُ أَوْ غَسَلَهُ أَجْزَأَهُ ذَلِكَ. Someone divide his wudu, or he doesn't do it like in one go, it's still fine. Whether it is long period or short period, as long as he doesn't do any, nothing happened to him in between the period, so there is no hadith in between the period of where, for example, he washes his face, hand, face and hands, and then what happens? He loses his wudu, then he has to repeat it again. But if he washes his face, for example, and then something, nothing happens, it's, he goes and do something else, come back and continue his wudu, then his wudu is fine. وَمَا لَمْ يَحْدِثْ فِي خِلَالِ غُسْلِهِ مَا يَنْقُضِ الْغُسْلِ. Also, if he starts غُسْل and he doesn't finish, and then he stops, do something else, and then continue his غُسْل, is fine. As long as nothing happens in between the غُسْل to break his غُسْل. Of course, the حَدَث of غُسْل is only جَنَابَة. I mean, if you do any حَدَث during the غُسْل, that will not break his غُسْل, because he's not doing غُسْل for حَدَث. This is what he didn't explain here, but probably that's what he means. That way, he said, "برهان ذلك أن الله عز وجل أمر بالطهور من الجنابة والحيض وبالوضوء من الأحداث ولم يشترط في ذلك متابعة." He said, "Allah ordered us to do tahara, which is غسل, from جنابة and for women for menses, and also وضوء from حدث." He said, "There was no condition that it has to be one after the other." So anyway, the man or the person does it is fine, because what he is doing is called tahara or ghusl or wudu. And for wudu, if he washes his face and hands, for example, and stops, and then washes and wipe his head and his feet, or wash his feet, then he can say, "I have done them," even if he has not done them one after the other. And then he brings the hadith here from Hammad ibn Salama, from Ata ibn Sa'ib, from Abi Salama ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, from Aisha, that she said, the Prophet used, if he want to do ghusl of janaba, what he used to do is he will start, washes his hand 3 times. Then he will take water from his hand with the right hand and put it on the left hand, and then he will wash his private parts. Then he will wash afterwards, he will wash his hands properly. Then he will do matmada, and then istinshaq, and then he will wash his face 3 times. And then he will wash his arms, the hands up to the arms. Here it says the arms. Then he will pour water on his hands, on his head 3 times, and he will wash his body, and then when he finish, he will wash his feet. This hadith here, which he narrated directly from Hammad ibn Salama, from the book of Hammad ibn Salama. Of course, Hammad ibn Salama is so and so. From Ata ibn Sa'ib. Ata ibn Sa'ib, some muhaddithin say he is fine. He is like, he was okay before, but we all agree that when he became old, he lost his memory, he forgot a lot of hadith. But many people say Hammad ibn Salama from Ata ibn Sa'ib. Of course, if Hammad ibn Salama was istiqa, according to Ibn Hazm, Hammad ibn Salama istiqa unanimously. Like according to Ibn Hazm, Hammad ibn Salama istiqa with no exception. He takes his hadith. You understand? So, and Hammad ibn Salama didn't hear anything from Ata after he became old. So they will say his hadith is sahih. However, Ata ibn Sa'ib is someone who is not really very strong in hadith, whether after he became mukhtalit or before that. If you go, for example, we spoke about Ibrahim ibn al-Muhajir before. Ibrahim ibn al-Muhajir, when Ibn Abi Hatim, Abu Hatim was asked about, Ibn Abi Hatim said, he asked his father regarding Ibrahim ibn al-Muhajir. He said he is not weak, he is not trustworthy, he is weak. And he compared him to Ata ibn Sa'ib. He said, these people, they don't memorize. He didn't say like when they were old or something. For him, he is ضعيف before and after. So, but this hadith here that he mentioned, even though this hadith came in, we have it in Bukhari and in Muslim from different narration. So what he wants to say from this hadith is that the Prophet did wudu. He didn't do the full wudu. He did his face, hands, and then he started pouring water on his head. He finished his body and he washed his feet at the end. So in between the wudu, he had done something different, which is ghusl. You understand? He say, if it's possible, if it was right for the Prophet to do between his wudu, in between his wudu ghusl, and he left his feet to the end, so there was a time gap between them, then there is nothing to say that these timing should be limited. So if you can put 1 minute before between one limb and another, why not 5 minutes? Why not 5 hours then? Like, you understand? You say, if you want to put a limit, then you have to say where you got it from. And then he says, وَهَذَا قَوْلُ السَّلَفِ. This is the saying of the Salaf. So the way we narrate it from Malik, from Nafi', from Ibn Umar, that he urinated in the market, then he did wudu. He washed his face, his hands, and then he wiped over his head. And then he was called to janaza. He went to the mosque to pray. So when he got there, when he got to the mosque, he wiped over his feet. So he did part of his wudu. And then when he was called to the janaza, he went and he wiped only when he got to the mosque, he wiped his feet. So he didn't do wudu directly. He went to the mosque and continued his wudu. He said also, we narrated from Sufyan al-Thawri, from al-Mughira, from Ibrahim, كان أحدهم يصل رأسه من الجنابة بالصدر ثم يمكث ساعة ثم يصل سائر جسده. He said, some of the people that he met, Ibrahim al-Nakhai is a student of Alqama al-Aswad. He is the student of the students of Ibn Mas'ud. He said, people in his time, he saw some people of the Tabi'in, sometimes they wash their heads. And then they go somewhere else and they wash the full body. They stay for some time, like he washed his head because it's there is available water there, but he can't wash his body because probably he had to take his clothes or something. So he will go somewhere else and continue his ghusl. So he doesn't do it directly. He said also, he says Ibrahim is a big tabi'i. He met the big tabi'in and he met a lot of small sahaba. Ibrahim also said that a man, if he has like a wife or a slave girl and he need to do ghusl, it's fine to wash his head and then leave the rest of his body later. And he said he doesn't have to repeat the ghusl of his head because he already done it. Abd al-Razzaq also narrated from Ibn Jurayj, from Ata ibn Rabi Rabah here, not Ata ibn Sa'ib, that ghusl, the ghusl of Junub, if the Junub does ghusl and he washes his head with sidr or something, and then he wait until his head is dry, then that is enough. He can just go and continue wash his body. He doesn't have to repeat the washing of the head. And this is the saying of Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, Sufyan al-Thawri, Awza'i, al-Hasan ibn Hayy. And also this is narrated from Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib and Tawus. However, Malik said, if someone does this and there is a gap, then he has to repeat his wudu from the beginning. And he has to repeat his ghusl from the beginning. He said, as if it's not long enough, if there is only a small gap, then it's fine. He can continue his wudu and continue his ghusl. And this is narrated from Qatada and Ibn Abi Layla and others. And the limit that they have put for this, they said, if they dry. He said, if someone, like for example, does wudu, he washes his face, he does the madmada istinshaq, wash his face, and then he washes his hands, and then stop he can continue later. They say like this. He said, but if his body is dry, then he has to repeat from the beginning. This is the Malik. He said, he said, this is, for example, someone who's doing wudu, and he ran out of water, and he is going to look for water. Like, they gave reasons like this, not for every, if there is no reason, some people say no. He said also, as for the Malik saying that a long period and small period, he said the person who follow the madhab of Malik here must say where he got this from, and what is the limit, like what is the long period, what is small period. He said, and they have to get it from the religion. If they can't get it, then this is a claim, and it will be baseless. And any claim that has no base, then he is invalid, because the Sharia is to be taken only from Sharia, which is wajib. It has to be taken from the Quran and Sunnah. He said, as for those who said it has to be the period which is long or small, we look at the person when if it dries or doesn't dry. He said, this is a claim which has no proof, so it is invalid. Also, there is a place where are hot in the summer. He said, you don't finish your wudu before you finish, before you go to the second limb, already the face, for example, is dry. He say that means that his wudu, this person can never do wudu. He said, or some people said, as long as the person is looking for water. He said, so if you are okay, you are doing wudu, and then you run out of water, you are looking for water. As long as you are looking for water, it's fine. If you stop looking for the water, you have to do it again. You understand? He said, this is also a say without proof. He said, and according to the Malikis, he said, it doesn't work with for them. He said, it's a wonder that the Malikis have said something like this, because they say, according to the madhab of the Malikis, if someone is praying, and then he has blood, ru'af, he has blood coming out of his nose, he say he can go and do wudu again. He must do wudu. But then he can come back and continue his prayer, not pray from the beginning. You understand? So he say the salah which has been prayed, like the Prophet said, pray the way you see me praying. And he never put a gap between the prayer. And so he say, they come to the prayer, and then they say you can have a gap between, you can do something in between. Say, and then they come to the wudu, which there is nothing to say that you have to do it one after the other. If, and then they say you have to do it one after the other.
What if you forgot?
When you forgot the prayer, well, that is a mistake. And everything in between that you have done in the prayer will be invalid. Someone prayed 2 rak'ah, and then he has forgotten that it is 4, and he stopped the prayer. And then he go and do something, buy something or get married, or, and then he remember, I prayed only 2 rak'ah. Then he will pray 2 rak'ah again, do sujood sahu, whatever happened in between, as long as he has his wudu, of course. Anything that happens in between is invalid, because he was still in prayer. He was not supposed to do what he has done. This is the hadith, of course, taken from the hadith of Abu Huraira and Ibn Mas'ud, that the Prophet prayed 2 rak'ah, and then he was told, he has spoken to people, and then he was told that you have made, that you have forgotten, you prayed 2 rak'ah, then he continued 2 rak'ah. But because he is in the prayer, whatever action he has done in between should be invalid. But the Ahnaf and the Malikis, when they say you can pray 2 rak'ah, and then, for example, 1 rak'ah, 2 rak'ah, whatever, and then in the between, if there is something, like you lose your wudu, then you can go losing wudu in a specific case, like blood, bleeding nose. Mm-hmm. Then they say you can do wudu and come back and continue your prayer. and you don't talk in between. You shouldn't talk. It's based on hadith. Hadith which is narrated by Dharqutni and graded by the majority of the muhaddithin to be either weak or batil or invalid, munkar. So he said also, فإن تعلق بعضهم بخبر رواه عن رسول الله, if some of them mentions the hadith which is narrated by Baqiyya from Buhayr, from Khalid, from some companions of the Prophet, that the Prophet saw a man praying and in his feet there was a place, a small place where water didn't touch. So the Prophet ordered him to repeat the wudu and the prayer. He said this hadith is not sahih. This hadith is not sahih, and he gives the reasons. He said because it is the narration of Baqiyya and he is not strong. And in the isnad, there is people who are not known. So the problem here is Baqiyya. Baqiyya ibn al-Walid is weak, according to some. But he is also, those who consider him to be trustworthy, those who consider Baqiyya to be trustworthy, they say he is mudallis. He is mudallis tadlis taswiya. Do you remember tadlis taswiya? Tadlis taswiya is like tadlis of al-Walid ibn Muslim. What he does, he will look at, take the isnad. The mudallisin, what they do? They hide their teacher if he is weak. This is what the mudallisin do. Like someone, Sufyan al-Thawri, he is a mudallis. If he narrates from someone who is weak, his teacher is weak, he will hide him, he will not mention him. He will mention the teacher of his teacher. And don't say, I heard him. He will say, from Abi Razin. Sufyan al-Thawri will say, from Abi Razin. When people ask him, did you hear this hadith from Abi Razin directly? He will say, no, I heard it from Abu Hanifa. So he will hide, because he doesn't want people to know that he narrated from Abi Hanifa. Mudallis. Sufyan al-Thawri, Qatada, Hassan al-Basri are known to be mudallisin. This is easy mutadlis. Bukhari, for example, when he mentioned these people, he makes sure that they are say haddathana. This is easy tadlis, not problem. The problem of tadlis is tadlis taswiya, that there is two people who do it, al-Walid ibn Muslim and Baqiyya ibn al-Walid. What they do? They go to the isnad, the whole isnad. Anyone weak in the isnad, they take him off. That is very difficult.
So Walid and Baqiyya who?
Baqiyya ibn al-Walid. Now these people, if they narrate hadith, al-Walid ibn Muslim is thiqa, trustworthy. Baqiyya ibn al-Walid is not thiqa, so you don't care about him. But al-Walid ibn Muslim, if you take his hadith, you have to make sure that he said haddathana from the beginning to the end. You understand? So, and they have said this before. And he, of course, in the isnad here, this hadith is very weak, because Baqiyya ibn al-Walid is ta'if, mudallis, Buhayr is unknown, nobody from the muhaddithin know him. Khalid is not even known who is this Khalid. From some sahaba, he didn't mention who are they. So this hadith is one of the, you can call it very, very weak, not weak only. Also narrated from Khalid al-Hadda, from Abi Qilaba, that Umar ibn al-Khattab, and from Abi Sufyan, from Jabir, from Umar ibn al-Khattab, that he saw a man praying and he left something on his feet, placed almost like a fingernail on his foot without water touching it. That Umar ibn al-Khattab said that he must repeat the wudu. He says here, Ali says, the narration from Umar is not correct. That's what he says. He said, لِأَنَّ أَبَا قِلَابَ لَمْ يُدْرِكْ عُمَرَ. He said, because Abu Qulaba never met Umar. And that is true. But also Abu Sufyan ضعيف. Abu Sufyan, we said, there is different opinions about Abu Sufyan. Not Abu Sufyan the Sahabi, Abu Sufyan who narrates from Jabir. This is a different person. However, Abu Sufyan is Muslim, narrates from Abu Sufyan and Bukhari. So, also, وقد جاء أثر عن رسول الله وأحسن من هذا. He said, there is a hadith from the Prophet is better than this. This hadith is narrated by Ibn Wahab from Jarir ibn Hazm from Qatada from Anas that the Prophet came and he saw a man. The Prophet came to Anas ibn Malik and he had done wudu and he left a place on his body in lieu of wudu that water didn't touch. So the Prophet said, "Go and perfect your wudu." This hadith is in Muslim. But of course, he said, and from Ibn Wahab, from Ibn Lahi'a, from Abi Zubair, from Jabir, from Umar, something similar. The hadith which is in Muslim here is not the hadith which is, of course, in the from Anas, it's the one from Jabir, from Umar. Ali said here, لا يصح عن أحد من الصحابة خلاف فعل عمر هذا. There is nothing from the Sahaba that is contradicting what Umar have said here. This is only to say against the Shafi'is. The Shafi'is say if Sahabi does something, there is no Sahabi who contradicted him, then it should be taken. He said, so there is no Sahabi who contradicted this. He said, here they have contradicting he's talking about the Malikis here. He said they have contradicted a Sahabi, that there is no Sahabi who has contradicted him. The rule is the rule of Shafi'is, used by the other Madahib, of course. He says, with yaqeen, with certainty, we know, and everybody who knows, that knows as well, everybody who has knowledge know, that time's passing, the time which pass is not a hadith that breaks wudu. Like time doesn't break wudu. Do you understand this? Yeah? I mean, time passed. Does time break wudu? Time doesn't break wudu. He said, and Malik didn't keep to his saying in this place. Because he said, if someone does wudu and forget one limb, then he remembers later, he can wash it. Only if, you understand, someone has done wudu, washed his face, wiped his hair, washed his feet, and then later remembers that he has forgotten the hands, he says he can wash his hands. Of course, because in his madhab, he says that you don't have to do wudu in order. Also, he says that whoever does wudu and do mash on the khuffain and he stays there that way all the day and then he takes his khuff, then he should do wudu. The wudu of his feet has broken. You know this madhab. Some people say if you do wudu and you do mash, then if you take the socks or the khuff, then the wudu, you have to do ghusl of the feet. Some say that you have to repeat the wudu altogether. But this is the saying of the majority. Not everybody agree about this. And Malik here, what he says, if you do wudu, and then you have done mash, the problem here only is that the followers of Malik say Malik doesn't agree about mash altogether. This is narrations of Malik. And then they say, he says that you can do mash whatever, like not specific time. You can do mash 7 days. You can. And then they say, he takes your socks after you have done mash, then you have to do. So you see how can he be saying that mash you can't do it at all? In the meantime, if you take your socks, you can. So this is probably the different narrators. Probably it was his old madhab, then later madhab, Allah alam. But this is how, when it comes to the known people of the madhab of Malik, such as Ibn al-Qasim and Sahnoon and these people say that he didn't used to say that he doesn't agree about mash altogether. But yeah, he says here he didn't keep to his saying because he says if someone have done mash and for long he stayed for hours and then he took off his socks, then he can wash only his feet. So this is wudu, which has been, there is a gap in between. You understand? He said, and this is tab'id al-wudu, which he said, this is wudu, doing wudu after with a gap, which he originally said it shouldn't happen. And then mas'ala 208, mas'ala. He said, and it is makruh to use a lot of water, whether in the ghusl or in the wudu. That's what he says. He said, doing more than three times while washing the limbs for wudu and wiping over the head also is makruh. That is because the Prophet didn't do more than three times. He said, we narrated from Sufyan al-Thawri, from Abi Ishaq. Narrated from Abi Ishaq, Sufyan al-Thawri, from Abi Ishaq, from Abi Hayya ibn Qais, that Ali did wudu three times. And then he said, this is the way I saw the Prophet doing wudu. And from Ibn Mubarak, of course, the hadith of Abi Ishaq, from Abi Hayya. Abi Hayya from Ali ibn Abi Talib, this hadith is not strong. Because Abu Hayya is not really, you can't put him in between either unknown or weak. And then another hadith from Ibn Mubarak, from Al-Awza'i, from Al-Muttalib ibn Abdullah ibn Huntub, that Abdullah ibn Umar did wudu three times. And then he said that the Prophet did it. And from Uthman, something similar. Of course, the hadith of Uthman is known hadith, is in Bukhari and Muslim. So he said he didn't mention, now this Sahaba, he said they didn't say anything about feet or about head. You understand? So he said three times. This is the madhab of Shafi'i and Ibn Hazm. They say, because the Sahaba said the Prophet used to do wudu three times. That means three times. Even the head, like the head, one, two, three, or one, two, three. This is the madhab of Shafi'i and Ibn Hazm. But this is, you see, there is difference between the Sahabi explaining the way the Prophet did wudu. And you want to... So when the Sahabi is explaining, like Uthman, he's explaining the wudu of the Prophet, he explained it, he didn't mention three times the head, neither the feet. But then when he put it like, the Prophet did wudu three times. You understand? This is like a mukhtasar, a summary. So, like when we say the Adhan is even or odd. You understand? So is the Iqama is odd? Is the Iqama odd? Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, that is not odd. That is two. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, hayya al-salah, hayya al-falah, qad qamat al-salah, but people say it's odd. Because it's odd, most of it is odd. You understand? So when he say that the wudu of the Prophet three times, that is because madmada, istinshaq, the hands three times, face three times, but the head doesn't mean the head is three times or the feet. There is no hadith that say the Prophet washed his feet three times. Because for the feet, we need more water sometimes. And the head is mash. We don't need, there is no hadith sahih that describes the wudu of the Prophet and he says three times for the head. Except that when it comes general. General, you have to look like this is mujmal, this is mufassar. You understand? When he said general, summary, you look at the other hadith. So he's saying here that it's three times. And then he mentioned another hadith from Ahmed ibn Shu'aib, which is al-Nasa'i, from Muhammad ibn Mansur, from Sufyan, Sufyan Thawri, from Amr ibn Yahya, from his father, from Abdullah ibn Zayd. He says that Ra'aytu Rasulullah, Sufyan is Sufyan ibn Uyayna here. He said, Ra'aytu Rasulullah tawadza'a faghasala wajhahu thalathan. I saw the Prophet did wudu. He washed his face three times and his hands two times and wiped his head two times. This here, wiped his head two times, people say it's a mistake. Because the majority of people who narrated this hadith from Abdullah ibn Zayd didn't say it. He said it actually one time. Okay. Like he went with his head and came back. And these who say two times, they say either is mistake, shadh, or he meant this one time going and coming back, he called it two times.
is also narrated from Anas that the Prophet wiped his head in the wudu 3 or 2. And from Abd al-Razzaq, from Ibn Jurayj, from Ata, that he used to do masḥ. So that is from Anas, that he used to do wudu masḥ 3 or 2 times. And from Ata, that he does masḥ 3 times. No more, no less. And he used to do it actually with one hand. And from Muhammad ibn Salama, from Jarir ibn Hazim, that he saw Muhammad ibn Sirin did wudu and he wiped his head 2 times. So what he did, he washed his face with the rest of the water on his head, and he wiped his head. And then after that, he took new water and he did it again. And from Abi Ubaid, from Hushaym, from Al-Awwam, that Ibrahim Al-Taymi, Ibrahim Al-Taymi, who is Ibrahim Al-Taymi? He's the father of Muhammad bin Ibrahim Taymi.
Okay. Yahya. Muhammad bin Yahya Taymi?
No, Muhammad bin Ibrahim Taymi. Yahya bin Sa'id al-Ansari. He said, Ibrahim Taymi used to do masḥ 3 times. And this is the saying of Shafi'i and Dawud bin Ali and others. As for doing, using water a lot, he said, it's makruh by everybody. You understand? It is considered makruh by the everybody based on the hadith of Alhamdulillah. It's makruh by everybody that we know based on hadith of Amr ibn Shu'aib from his father, from his grandfather. Ahmed ibn Shu'aib is the Nasa'i.
Okay.
Yeah. Amr ibn Shu'aib is the grandson, great grandson of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, the Sahabi. He narrates hadith, people have different opinions about him. More likely to be weak. Yeah? He narrated the hadith where he said that the Prophet did wudu 3 times, and this hadith is very, very famous. Even the people who narrated it from Amr ibn Shu'aib are weak, like Muthanna ibn Sabbah and Ibn Lahi'a. They narrated this hadith from him. And many people consider this hadith to be da'if. However, it is, you find it in a lot in the books of fiqh, that the Prophet did wudu 3 times. When he finished, he said, this is the wudu. Whoever does less or more, فَقَدْ أَسَاءَ وَتَعَدَّى وَظَلَمَ. Whoever does more or less, he has transgressed and he has done bad. Yes, and ظَلَم. And then the people consider this hadith to be weak, even from the Arabic language, because when someone does less, you don't call that ظُلم. You understand? You don't call that extravagance. When you do more, extravagance probably, but not less. It's a wrong. So this hadith is weak actually. The Prophet did wudu 1 time, 2 times, and 3 times. That's what he did. But he was supposed to do wudu only. He didn't say more or less. So if you do wudu, for example, someone did wudu and 3 times, which is definitely the mustahab. It's better to do 3 times. Because the hadith of Uthman, the Prophet used to do wudu 3 times. Did wudu 3 times and say to whoever does wudu this way and then pray 2 rak'ah, yeah, not talking to himself, then Allah will forgive his past sins. So that is the wudu, the perfect wudu. Mm-hmm. However, doing less than 3 times, there is nothing to say you can't do it. There is hadith of Ibn Abbas that the Prophet did wudu one time.
Yeah, this is Bukhari.
This is Bukhari. Yeah. So there is nothing to say less, they don't say anything about it. Mm-hmm. They say more than 3 times. But 3 times, let's say someone is doing wudu. Mm-hmm. He done it 3 times. But then he discovered that he didn't, there is a place that, well, yeah, definitely you have to do the 4th time here.
So then when I mentioned a few days ago, when he said, I'm gonna do more, so then Yom Kiyamah.
No, that is Abu Huraira.
Huraira, yeah.
Yeah, he used to wash up to here.
Yeah.
And he washed up to the. Yeah.
So he's not extravagant, but he's extending
the wudu.
Yeah.
Yeah, and some people consider it to be some people commented on that. They said it is still useless. You understand?
Yeah, it is.
Like Ibn al-Qayyim says that is a mistake. Ibn al-Qayyim comment on it, saying it's a mistake. According to the rules, that it will be, you see, when you do something and you consider it to be ibadah when it isn't. You understand? So, but it is just a mistake from someone. Yeah. I mean, it's not part from the religion, but it depends on the person how he does it, of course, whether he knows or he doesn't know. He said, narrated here another hadith from Hafsa bint Abd al-Rahman bin Abi Bakr. She was the wife of Al-Mundir bin Zubair, said that Aisha told her that she used to do ghusl, she and with the Prophet, from one place, from one
container.
Three amdad, or qariban min dalik. Three mud. Well, mud is not this. It's bigger. Yeah. The mud will be this big. Huh? Yeah. So the container of three mud, she used to do ghusl from it, she and the Prophet. And also narrated from Abbad ibn Tamim from his mother, Umara, that the Prophet did wudu, from a container which is almost two-thirds of a mud. That is very little water for a ghusl. The Prophet. That he did wudu from container which is two-thirds of a mud. It's not full mud. I mean, full mud, it will be still a problem. Little water. Also narrated from Muslim, from the hadith of Ibn Abbas here, that he saw the Prophet, woke up from sleep, then he went to a container of water. He did wudu and did wudu, and he did siwak and wudu. He did wudu properly, and he didn't spend, he didn't use except little of water. Of course, this is, it makes sense that you are in Medina, you have to go to the well to get water home. Of course, you have to be careful because you are just putting pressure on the people who are going to this well to get water. They didn't have water in the house, or you understand? There was wells out where people have to go and get water every day. Also, Ali said, there is so many hadith from the Prophet that he used to do wudu with mud, and he used to do ghusl with a sa'ah. And also that the Prophet used to do wudu with makuk, and he did ghusl with five makaki. Ghusl five. Makuk is something which is called like sa'ah, four of it. So, also, he used to do wudu from a container which is equal to one mud and a quarter of it. He said all of these are the same thing. It's only what is enough. You just do wudu with what is enough. So there is no specific amount of water that you have to use. And you will find in the books of fiqh that if you take the books of fiqh, we will find thousands of pages deciding where, how much water you have to do, to use. Well, you just use as much water as you need. Of course, israf is haram. If you throw water just like this for the sake of throwing water, it's haram. Water is property. I mean, when you go and get water and bring it home, that becomes your property. And throwing property away is haram. Even though water is not to be sold, it is property. And throwing property is israf, extravagance. Extravagance is haram. You are at the sea or something, then the hadith that says that you shouldn't do israf, extravagance, even if you are in the sea, that hadith is weak. So if you are in the sea, I want to jump inside the water and jump again and again and again, that is your business. Or you have to know that when you jump the first time, if you have ghusl obligation, the ghusl is gone. Now jumping again for other things, that is
that's your business. You mean janaba?
Yeah, someone for janaba.
Yeah, you say ghusl, if you have ghusl, ghusl.
If someone has ghusl, for example, for janaba, and he goes in that, inside the sea, he has finished his ghusl. The second ghusl, if he jumps again, what will be? What it will be? It will be bid'ah if he does it with the intention of ibadah. Because he has already done ghusl. What is bid'ah? Bid'ah is to do something in the religion. To do something, trying to adding something to the religion. Now you went to the sea. You jumped in the sea, and you went out with the intention also of janaba. You have no janaba anymore.
Yeah.
Now if you jump again, you think that doing it twice or three times or four times that you are adding to the religion.
Huh? If someone has a janaba,
yeah,
and he cannot become like a media and just go to the toilet and wash it,
yeah,
or like a normal, he still has a janaba or...
He still has janaba. If there is no intention, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. So if he doesn't do the niyyah,
yeah,
then he is ghusl of janaba. Is everything that you do, you have to do it with intention. If someone need to do ghusl jum'ah, and he go to, he has... Friday, there is ghusl jum'ah, there is ghusl janaba. He does one ghusl with for janaba, but he doesn't think about jum'ah.
In this case, the individual would know that, as you said, he didn't make intention.
Yeah.
He forgot.
Yeah.
Then he's in his mind, it's okay. Is that you? No, if you don't have wudu,
yeah,
you don't do it again. It's hadith. So if I'm walking now, I'm not sure if I have wudu or not.
Yeah.
I'm still praying in the masjid.
You?
Say now I did wudu hours ago.
Yeah.
I prayed Fajr or whatever.
Yeah.
Alhamdulillah, now I was doing. And I'm not sure if I have wudu or not.
Yeah.
I can still pray.
Yeah. But it's because you had wudu.
Yeah.
You had wudu.
Yeah.
And then now you are not sure if you have that wudu or not. You understand? And you always go with the yaqeen.
Yeah.
You go with the certainty. Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الظَّنَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْءٍ. The dhan, suspicion, doesn't change from the truth anything. Now, you had wudu. Now, maybe I lost my wudu, maybe not. So you still have wudu. But let's say, now you lost your wudu. You are sure you lost your wudu. And then you go to the wudu. You will walk there, and then you come back, and then you don't know. I know that I had no wudu. And then he went there to do wudu, but I don't remember if I done it or not, because I was busy, I was talking. Then you have no wudu. Because you were sure you have no wudu. You went there, you are in doubt whether you did it or not. Always you follow the certainty. Like you woke up from sleep. Night time you woke up from sleep. And then you woke up from sleep, you have to do wudu. And you are not sure you did it or not, then you have no wudu. Always you follow the certainty in everything. He said also, okay, مسألة 209. ومن كان على ذراعيه أو أصابعه أو رجليه جبائر أو دواء ملصق لضرورة فليس عليه أن يمسح على شيء من ذلك وقد سقط حكم ذلك المكان. فإن سقط شيء من ذلك بعد تمام الوضوء فليس عليه إمساس ذلك المكان بالماء وهو على طهارته ما لم يحدث. See, if someone does wudu and then he has some patches on his body, like he has injury and he has some patches or jabira or bandages, or he said then he does wudu what he can, and the place where there is the bandage he doesn't have to wipe over it. He said the wudu is complete, he doesn't have to do mash on it, and his wudu is complete. He said proof for that, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. He said لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. You have bandage on your body, this place is injured, then you can't reach it. You understand? You can't reach it to do wudu on it. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said, إذا أمرتكم بأمر فأتوا منه ما استطعتم. If I order you something, you do what you can. This person can't. He said, فسقط بالقرآن والسنة كل ما جاز عنه المرء. Whatever the Quran and Sunnah have taken away the responsibility from you. I mean, you don't have to do what you can't. And to say that now that you can't wipe, that you can't wash your hand, to say you can't, okay, you can't wash your hand. Now to say that because you can't wash it, you have to wipe over the Jabira, you say this is a Sharia that we have to take from Quran and Sunnah. Since there is the Quran and Sunnah that says you have to wipe, then you don't have to wipe. He said also a Shara' is only taken by Quran and Sunnah. And there is no Quran and Sunnah to say that you have to wipe over the Jabira and over the medication, if someone is putting some medication or something. And to do something instead of the places that you can't wash. He said, if someone says that there is a hadith from Zayd, from his father, from his grandfather, from Ali, that he asked the Prophet, أَمْسَحُ عَلَى الْجَبَائِرِ, he said, yes, wipe over it. There is a hadith that Ali ibn Abi Talib, this hadith actually is from Zayd, from his father, from his grandfather, that Ali ibn Abi Talib was asked the Prophet, should I do wiping over the Jabira? Jabira is the bandage. That the Prophet said, yes, wipe over it. He said, this hadith, لا تحل روايته إلا على بيان سقوطه لأنه انفرد به أبو خالد عمرو بن خالد الواسطي وهو مذكور بالكذب. He said, this hadith is narrated by Abu Khalid, عمرو بن خالد, and he is known to be a liar. وكيع بن الجراح, the muhaddith of Kufa, said this person used to live next to us, and he was a liar. He used to make hadith. The hadith of Zayd ibn Ali from his father, from his grandfather, from Ali ibn Abi Talib, this is the book of Shia. It is well known. Now it is decided, this book. But it is a made up book. It's all invalid.
So lies.
All the hadith from the beginning to the end is all lies.
So if I find hadith Umar ibn Khalid, or any hadith from Zayd, his grandfather.
Zayd from his father, from grandfather. Hadith. Of course you have to work out from who is Zayd. But there is no in the narrators who is called Zayd ibn Ali from his father, from his grandfather, except this.
Okay.
He is from the descendant of the Prophet. He's not Zayd himself is not a liar.
Yeah, yeah.
Zayd himself is not a liar.
Yeah, yeah.
The person who narrates from him.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, okay.
So he made it. He made up this. You understand? فإن قيل, he said, if someone says there is a hadith from the Prophet that he ordered the Sahaba to wipe over the asaib, something that you put around your head, and tasakhin. He said this hadith also doesn't come from any, has no isnad sahih. You understand? So he denies that this hadith has isnad. And he said also if it was sahih, the asaib means amaim. You understand? Asaib in the Arabic language, he say if this hadith was sahih, this hadith he says that he has no isnad. I remember that there was isnad for it. This hadith is invalid, but it has isnad. But he says also, anyway, the asaib and tasakhin that they used in this hadith, because this hadith is used in the books of the fiqh of the Mali of the Hanafis. He said the asaib means imama, and he mentioned here Farazdaq said وَرَكْبٌ كَأَنَّ الرِّيحَ تَطْلُبُ عِنْدَهُمْ لَهَا تِرَةٌ مِنْ جَذْبِهَا بِالْعَصَائِبِ. So he said clearly from this poet of Farazdaq, and Farazdaq was of one of the biggest poets in his time, he said clearly that he mentioned the asaib, which means amaim. Yeah, so he said this in Arabic language, asaib still amama. So this hadith, you can't use it. This hadith, you can find it in all the books of fiqh of the Ahnaf, for example, referring to it when they say that you can do wiping over the. Also, he said, those who have done masḥ, who say you have to do masḥ on the bandages, they do it qiyas on the masḥ of the khufayn. And qiyas is invalid. So if the qiyas was true, this was still invalid. Because masḥ on the khufayn, there is timing on it. And they don't make timing on the jaba'ir, on the bandages. You say because bandages may last for a long time.
And also, if someone says, because it's fine to do masḥ on the khuffain, it's you have to do masḥ on the jaba'ir. This is just da'wah. This is just what we call his claim without dalil. And it has been made in a wrong way.
Sorry, not to fast in Ramadan, not to eat, not to drink in Ramadan from 2 o'clock in the morning until 9 o'clock in the heat, in the August when it's hot, it's difficult. That is yusr. You understand? That is where Allah says yusr. Of course, if it's too much to bear, that is, you use this ayah and say, of course, eating and drinking, because definitely some people will feel it's difficult, fasting. Especially in Medina, you understand? Not to fast is easier. But that ayah, of course, Allah says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ, after he mentioned that you have to fast. So that is yusr. Of course, you use the ayah if it's very difficult, if something that is unbearable, the pain is unbearable, then yeah, you go and eat or drink. And here, what you are talking, when you use this ayah, this ayah, you can use it generally. But we are not saying you have to do wudu. You have to do it the way Allah ordered you to do it. Now, there is a place that you can't do. There is a place in your hand that you can't do wudu because it's covered. Nobody is telling you you have to do wudu in it. Let's say you have bandage here. You can wash this place. Nobody is telling you put water on the bandage, wash the bandage. Nobody will tell you put water under the bandage even though it will hurt you or make the injury worse. What he is telling you, the Sharia say do what you can. Now you can't do this area, don't go and create new Sharia from your head.
Okay.
Wiping over it. It's like, okay, you have to wash your hand. Now, if someone, his head is cut from this side, can he do wudu up to here and count, okay, and more? Or, you understand?
Yeah, I understand. Try to make up for it.
That is, make it up for it. Or take, that is, we'll be doing a new Sharia.
Yeah.
Do what you can, but if you can't do something, don't go and replace it with your, from just your, you understand? He said also, the person who said that you can do wiping over the jabira, over the bandage, and do qiyas over the feet, he said that qiyas is invalid. Because wiping over the feet on the socks or whatever, leather socks,
yeah,
it has timing, it has also, it is question of ikhtiyar, choice. You can do it, and you don't have to do it. If you can wash or do it, but on the jabira, he says you have to. So that is invalid qiyas. The qiyas, you do qiyas something on something if they are have similar characteristics, like not wajib on something which is you have the choice of it. He narrates here. He said some of the salaf say the same what we say. And he mentioned of the Salaf who said this, Ibn al-Mubarak from Sufyan al-Thawri, from Abdul Malik ibn Abjar, from Sha'bi, that he said, if someone has an injury, wash what is next to it, next to the injury. Someone, for example, has injury in the middle, in the wrist, to wash his hand and to wash up on the top, as long as it doesn't make sure that the water doesn't go to the injury or... He said also, he said, if they say, there is a hadith from Ibn Umar,
that he had something in marara on his finger.
Thorn?
No? I don't know what you call marara.
A bruise.
It's not something that comes on the in the finger. It's something that blood. You understand?
Blister.
Yeah, something. It's an almost an injury. Something that.
Yeah, finger number.
It's a problem. Yeah. So he used to wipe over it, meaning wiping over the bandage, putting bandage around it and over. We say this is an action from Ibn Umar. Not him saying it's an obligation to do it. Of course, if Ibn Umar does it, it's still, I mean, if anybody does it, you have to, why do you do it? You understand? Do you believe it has anything to do with the religion? If he does it just like this, I am wiping. You understand? I just passed my hand over it. Nothing. But if he believes that this is religion, it will be bid'ah. He said also, it has been narrated with isnad sahih that he used to put water in his eyes during the wudu and ghusl. Ibn Umar is known that he, when he does wudu, he used to take water and enter it into his eyes. Like, make sure that water goes. You see, when you wash your face, normally you will close your eyes. So he always makes sure that water goes inside his eyes, because he consider like wudu to be the washing the face, meaning you have to wash with it the mouth and the nose and the eyes. Anything, you understand? So he's saying, if you consider what Ibn Umar said here to be right, then say also that you have to make sure that water goes into your eyes. He said also, he used to, it was his, in his opinion, he used to say it is fine to sell a pregnant, not only woman, I mean pregnant, any woman or a slave or an animal. He used to say that it is fine to sell it with the exception of what she has in her womb. Ibn Umar used to say it's fine.
This is a woman.
Slave.
Slave.
He will say that you can sell her or an animal that is pregnant. He say you can sell them with the exception. You sell the person. Okay, I sell you this woman, but when the baby is mine, or you understand? He say, and this, according to the madhahib, is haram.
Yeah, yeah.
So he say, if you take what Ibn Umar say here, you have to take everything, including this. He say it is one of the haram things in the religion that you make a rule. You say this rule is religion, and then you take some of it and you leave some of it. He said, if it's sahih what we have mentioned, if we like we have mentioned earlier. If he says, if you do wudu the way we said, without wiping over the bandage, then that wudu is complete. You understand what he wants to say here? Do you understand what he's saying here? He wants to say, if someone has bandage and he has done wudu and completed his wudu without wiping over the bandage, without wiping over the bandage, and then later the bandage is taken off.
Okay.
Then he doesn't have to repeat his wudu.
Just like.
Because when he did the wudu, he did it in the correct way.
Yeah.
At the time when he did it, he didn't have to wash that. You understand?
Just like the socks or.
Yes. He said, and from those people who say that you can do masḥ, that you have to do masḥ on the bandage, are Abu Hanifa, Malik, and Shafi'i. But Zahir is, they refuse it. Okay. The issue of the last issue here, he didn't discuss it. 210. Yeah. The last issue, he said, if someone does wudu and he has bandage on his hand, when he did wudu, he had the bandage in his hand, then it was taken off just straight away after he finished the wudu. Then he doesn't have to wash, neither to do wudu again or wash his hand. He said, but because at the time when he did it, he didn't have to do it, to wash it, and then he became clean. He is doing prayer, he is clean. So to say taking off the bandage make him not clean again, you have to prove it, because taking the bandage off is not hadith. Do you understand this? Just like wiping over the socks and taking socks off, wiping over the imama or over the hair and then shaving, or wiping over the imama and take it off, or someone doing tayammum and when he finished the tayammum, start praying and then the tap start running because there was, you understand? Of course, about the water type start running, this is, we told you, I told you before, that is something that there is some hadith to look at. So we will talk about this, inshallah, later. Okay.